We can start. It is 6:30. Okay. Lynn's received a...
Well, we probably do, well, we start both alternates.
Both alternates? Okay, so Jessica and our regular members of the committee tonight, the commission. Okay, we all received the agenda. Notice any items?
We don't adopt it because it's a special meeting.
Don't adopt it because it's a special meeting, so we can't change it.
Correct.
Should have known that. Okay, first on the agenda is the minutes of the last meeting. Anyone notice any errors, omissions, corrections of that? 3 months ago? If not, I make a motion that we approve the agenda. I mean, the minutes of last meeting. Moved in second, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
So move. Under old business, I don't think we have anything new on the fire protection for the Kildare Mets re-subdivision. Stan, we usually have that information. I don't think he has any. And Jamie, the bond for the Savage Valley subdivision.
The subdivision was approved in July of 2008. For fire protection, we did receive a bond for $36,450. It's been 5 years. I wrote to them in February and asked them what their intentions were and have not heard anything.
So that was that a cash bond?
Surety bond.
Surety bond.
I don't know what the next step. I sent this by regular mail, if you want me to send it certified.
Well, we probably should. We're talking about it considerably.
We're talking about in July calling the bond, right?
Yeah.
We don't, are they at them?
You just sent one notice?
Regular mail.
Your regular mail?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, he got all the approvals.
Yeah.
They're well aware of what they're up to.
Okay.
Sure. Okay, no other old business. Moving on to new business. Jeff Haydock is here, and since he's my former son-in-law, I will recuse myself. And by recusing myself, I will exit the premises.
Without a cane?
Without a cane.
All right, very good.
All right.
It's got to be your shortest meeting, huh?
Yeah, right. Oh, no, we've been in short. We beat Pete Rayle's record. Betsy, you're in charge.
You're in charge.
You can stay right there, Betsy.
It's okay.
Jeff, you want to come up and explain what you're asking for?
Sure.
Yeah, they all got copies.
They all got copies, okay.
The letter and the one map, not the photos. Why did I do the photos?
This is a request by the owners of 20 South Ellsworth, Frank Cicero and Stacy Campbell, to install a pair of gates that would be installed outside of the, or right on the edge of the town right away. The actual center line of the gates is probably just over 25 feet from the center of the road when they're closed. However, because of the slope of the driveway, they would swing out into the town right away. So when they're open, they would project probably, they're 9 foot wide each, so they'll project out at 9 feet, but they probably open to 125 degrees or so. So if fully open, they might be 6 or 7 feet from the edge of the road. I think there's a plan in there. Did you all hear about the plan?
Yeah.
The reason for this is they have two small children that they're concerned about the traffic and the fact that nobody really obeys except for Larry, the speed limit along that stretch of road. And they are worried that because of the slope of the driveway, the kids, if they were, took their eyes off them for 2 seconds, they could roll out on a tricycle or chase a ball down the driveway into the road. They have...
And the Board of Selectmen did approve this.
Right.
There are other structures right along the road within...
Across the street.
Across the street that are 4 feet from the edge of the road, a permanent fence, and some plantings and stuff like that. So this is this would not project out as far as some of the other structures that are on, you know, adjacent properties.
The only caveat is if they ever widen the road, it would be a problem. I doubt if they will, but it is the town's right away.
What's the reason they're swinging out instead of in, Jeff?
The driveway sloped. It pitches down and so you can't open in.
It wouldn't open up.
You hit the asphalt.
That much for fishing.
Yeah, yeah. It's a fairly steep driveway. And fully open, I mean, they don't go much farther, right about there. It's about halfway to the edge of the road.
Does anyone have any questions?
No, I was there when Jeff was at the West Island meeting, so I'm familiar with it.
I buy it every day.
Do I hear a...
So moved.
So moved that it be allowed?
Yes.
Second? Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay.
Good luck.
Thank you.
You might tell them, if you see them this weekend, that I sighted a not fully mature bear very close to their house.
I heard that, yeah. He was at the church next door.
That's right, yeah, right on the other side of the road.
Yeah, well, I think he was actually on their side of the road.
Oh, okay, well, I saw it on the...
Somebody else called and said the same thing, keep an eye out.
Yeah, exactly.
The gate might not be there.
Yeah, no, I doubt it. Thank you very much.
Very good.
Aye.
Okay, Jessica, what have we got?
Okay, well, I guess when Jocelyn sent me her email today, the big thing that jumped out at me was that Jocelyn has a new job, which maybe all of you know, and maybe I'm the last person in the world that didn't know, but I've had a busy month at Indian Mountain. But Jocelyn has been hired as the new executive director of the Northwest Connecticut Council of Governments, replacing Dan McGinnis, who has retired. There's a quote here from Ruth. Since the collaborative's inception in 2007, it has had an ongoing supportive relationship with the COG, who has acted as its fiscal sponsor. The collaborative is thrilled to have Jocelyn heading up the COG, bringing her experience in planning, regulatory, grant writing, economic revitalization, and affordable housing to the organization. Jocelyn will continue to direct the activities of the collaborative, so she still will be with the collaborative, assisted by professional consultants on specific projects to benefit our towns. We look forward to continuing this ongoing work with Jocelyn, our towns, and our sponsors to support local businesses, keep our village centers vital places, and strengthen our local economies. The second thing that she wanted to make sure we knew, and this was something that I was unable to attend and really wanted to go to, but had a scheduling conflict. They had a meeting in Kent on May 14th to support local small businesses. It was called Help for Small Businesses in Your Town. So it was for town selectmen, Board of Finance, local economic development committee members, and small business owners, so they could learn about specific financing and tax incentive programs available to help small business finance any improvements and expand or create new jobs. I did share some of that information that I received from her. She sent me some of the handouts with the selectmen when I did a report on business in Sharon from the long range planning. And the third thing she wanted to make sure we knew was we continue to work on our initiatives to support local businesses by bringing more visitors to the region to eat, shop, stay, and play. We are actively marketing our visitor website, discovernwct.com, and the website Facebook page. Let's see, please visit the Facebook page and like it. We also have our visitor brochure in the state's five visitor centers. The new signage in Sharon will help direct people once they get here.
As I understand it, she has resigned from her position in Salisbury.
Yes.
Yeah, she was working for the board up there, as I understand it, a consultant.
Yes, she has. So she's still going to be with the collaborative, and she's going to be replacing Dan McGinnis. Which so I thought Dan McGinnis's position was full-time, but I don't know.
Well, they're down in 4 days. Now, wonder what's going to happen, because I think the selectmen, they just voted to join with the Litchfield Hills. So I don't know what's going to happen, really, with the COG.
I don't know what the future of the COG is.
And there's no, none that I know of, there's no conflict of interest her position, both as COG and the collaborative. She's still advisor? No, probably wouldn't be.
Probably complimenting.
Yeah, that's what I would think, too.
Good.
So I was happy to see that she went leaving the collaborative, so that was good. So there you go.
Okay, thanks.
Yep.
Jamie?
I don't want you to think I've done nothing, and that's why we haven't had a meeting in 3 months. I've done a lot. The paperwork is there. We had our first real use of our new height description in our regs. We now offer the illustration, which is really pretty important, because we have a potential, or an application, or an applicant who wants to build a structure that needed to be clarified whether or not it met the height requirement. It has somewhat of a glass dome type thing that exceeds the structure by at least 9 feet. What I did was I said that I needed Attorney Burns's opinion, written opinion, and the applicants are paying for it. So this is not an expensive admission. One of the towns in the area did include a chimney in their height requirement in their illustration. And when it went to court, you have to include everything because you included one rooftop structure. So they were at a point where they had to include everything on Widow's Peak, everything. Ours does not do that. We've done it pretty sensibly. And so anything over the roof is not counted in the height requirement. That's good for that. And I guess good for us, because I think the real intent is not to have four-story buildings.
Yeah.
I don't think the intent was...
No chimneys.
Structures. Well, this is a true structure.
Right.
Not a chimney.
Okay. And all the permits issued are passed around, I believe?
Yeah.
Okay. Any questions? And they're open to the public. Anybody wants to come in and see if they don't see them during the meeting? Okay. No further business? Make a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Wow.
No, it's second.
Second? Second, thank you. All the favors say aye?
Aye.
Okay.